Man Central.
I would love to show those wonderful pictures if that's okay.
Oh, let's okay. How about I'll just say a little bit about the genesis of our relationship, and then we can show the pictures because they're so sweet. Allison and I met in a long time ago in Alberta on a farm that I lived on. My sister Sandy and her husband Ron had a dairy farm in Alberta, and I lived in a little house there. Uh-oh, something's going on. I'm getting a phone call from my daughter. I'm going to decline that. Man. You know, me and technology, I have my phone muted.
She's going to be like, why is mom ignoring me?
Why is my mom ignoring me? Anyways, we lived on this farm, and I was to get married to Allison's uncle. And she came out from Montreal to stay with us, I don't know, maybe for a week or 2 weeks before. It was the wedding that was not to be, but we had a great time sort of hanging out on the farm and coming. You came from Montreal to stay with us in rural Alberta, which was a bit of a culture shock, I can imagine. So let's look at some of the photos, Shoshana, and then Ali, we can talk about them.
Okay.
Yeah.
I love this. Oh my gosh.
Here we go. Oh, look, here we are on the porch. There's your mom and Gregory and me and Allison on the front porch of my house in Alberta.
Oh, woohoo! Gosh. Look at us. Oh my God.
I know, so exciting.
Oh, this, I just got such a pang. I have such strong memories of that time.
And this is us sitting around the fire pit. So that's good fun. Oh, sorry. Now look, my QuickBooks wants to update. What the heck? All of a sudden, my computer's going crazy. Yeah, and here we are on the porch again. Oddly enough, I'm eating probably a chocolate chip cookie there in the door. I still have that little wooden man and you and your mom.
Oh.
And look, this is when I came to Montreal.
Gosh, I remember this so clearly.
Yeah, and there's David's dad, George.
Yeah. Yeah, and my little crying brother.
Yeah. Yeah, that was fun. Oh. And I had Montreal bagels for the first time, and that was fun.
Saint-Viateur, I hope.
Pardon?
Saint-Viateur bagels, I hope.
Yes,
in Montreal. Yes. Yes, okay.
And some Montreal smoked meat. And there's your grandma, Isabel. Yeah. And
oh
you.
My gosh.
I like goodness. Brenda Starr says, you look far too young to get married. I was like 27. I just was not that young. I was 27, something like that.
You were still a baby.
Still a baby.
I feel like 27 is still a baby.
Oh, those were the days, you know, 27. So when Poe Girl came to play at the Playhouse, and David said, oh yeah, Poe Girl's coming from Montreal, and there's this woman who's singing there, Alison Russell. I was like, hold up. So exciting. So
I think I know her. Well, yeah. And that was the wild thing. Like we did, neither Jackie nor I realized until that moment that we saw each other. And for me, you know, Jack, you look just the same. And it was like, oh my gosh. And for those of you, I don't even know, Jackie, if you know how influential that was, that time that I spent with you and David. My uncle is also David, which is confusing. But
David won.
Yeah, David won. And that you guys were pursuing careers in the arts, you know, with pride, unabashedly, just making it happen. And that was so, it was just mind opening, you know, just hugely so. And getting to go and see, you know, I remember during the Montreal Film Fest, going to see a movie that Jackie was in called Blood. That just like exploded my brain in so many ways.
That's
so
funny.
Many levels. But it was so powerful, you know, to see, and you were so strong that I remember you had just done, I think maybe you had just done a musical in Edmonton?
I was still in it.
You were still in it. That's what I remember.
I knew that I wasn't getting married when I signed the rider. I was like, I guess the wedding's off. I'm going to stay and do this show for a couple more weeks.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I mean, you know, and it all worked out. Like you each found, what I find so interesting is that Jackie and my Uncle David kind of each found other partners around the same time, had their kids, you know, with these other partners around the same time. I just think that's so interesting, that way that you guys kind of grew together for a bit and then you diverged, but you were on this sort of similar, I don't know, timeline somehow. It's just so interesting to me. And how, you know, that we came back into each other's lives, and we've, you know, my Van Poe girl played several times at the Arcata Playhouse, as did my, the band that I have with my partner JT called Birds of Chicago. We played there as well. So, you know, because of Jackie and the Arcata Playhouse and the incredible arts community, you know, in Humboldt County, the Arcata has come to feel like the second home. And it was such a, it was just such a thrill to see you again when we re-met at the Playhouse, because I have such strong memories of that time. That was the first trip I ever took. You know, that was the first time I was ever away from, you know, my adoptive father, who was very, very abusive. And that was my first trip ever away from him. So it just completely expanded my mind as to what was possible, even about songwriting. Like, I remember on that trip, there was also a Russell family reunion in Saskatchewan, I think. And we drove, we did, and we also went to Banff, I think, on it, like just to drive through the mountains, you know, to see the Rockies for the first time. And I have this very strong memory of driving through the Rockies. I think it was just with David at that point, and him playing me Tracy Chapman for the first time, you know, and I was just, I didn't know that women could write, you know. My adoptive father was someone who only, you know, anything written after 1820 was sort of, he was not about it. He was all about, you know, the Western canon, only, you know, only men, only white men, basically music, literature. And again, I'm not, I don't mean that in a, to disparage that part of the canon, but it was like women, there were no women creators that I knew of until I met you, you know, and that really changed my life. It, it opened up this possibility, you know, and which ended, I was an artist and didn't know that. I was a writer and didn't know that at that point, you know? So yeah, that's great. I just thought I wasn't good at anything until I met you. I was like, oh wait, there's a whole other world. There's a whole other world that's possible.
When did you start playing, when did you start playing the clarinet?
Not till many years later. I didn't, actually didn't come to, I didn't come to instruments until relatively late in my in my early 20s. I started playing the clarinet, and I'd always loved it. I'd always loved the sound, and I was sort of trapped in what I call the singer's ghetto, where if you, you know, if you're around other musicians and they say, oh, what do you play? And you say, I sing. They're like, oh, you're a singer. Like, you're not really, there's this funny thing that some musicians have about vocalists. And finally, and I was writing so many songs, and finally I just said, I can learn to play some chords. You know, I can learn to, I love the clarinet. Why don't I just try it? But what, how badly can it go? You know,
so, there's that joke, you know, how do you know when a singer's at your door? They never know when to come in. That's like the joke.
They can't find the key and they never know where to come in. I heard that joke. And, you know.
Well, what if we, what if we just boot out the gate with a song? Would that be okay? And then we'll come back around and chat some more and do some more singing. So just for everybody who's out there who's joined us, Allison Russell, so happy to have you here with us tonight, from Birds of Chicago, Poe Girl, also Our Native Daughters. We've been watching that documentary. I think we've shown it four times over of this festival for people to drop in and see it. Such a powerful documentary. If you haven't seen it, we'll probably show it again tomorrow. So check back in. So we'll let you know when. And yeah. And now, you know, you have your solo album coming out, so.
I do, yeah, it's coming out later this spring. There's gonna be a big announcement this coming Friday. So I'm excited. There'll be some more particulars and some new music coming on Friday. So I'm excited about that.
Cool.
But I will, let's see, I will play you. I think those pictures just, oh, just hit me in the heart. And my mom, Kathy, lives still with my adoptive father, who's very, very abusive man, was to me, was to my brother, is continues to be to my mother. And I've been thinking so much during this COVID time and all the various hardships and tragedies going on. But one of the things that hurts my heart more than anything is to know how many folks like my mom who are struggling with mental health issues, who are trapped in domestic violence situations, and everything has been exacerbated. Everything has been worsened by the pandemic as well. And this has just been a really fraught time for her and for so many. And so this is a song that I wrote for my mom, for Kathy. And it feels like I should play that now for her. Kathy, where'd the music go? Why'd you put down your French horn? Don't you play piano anymore? I used to crouch down underneath the pedals, moving with your feet while your hands carried you away. I remember. Do you remember? Kathy, where'd the music go? Don't you sing out anymore, those little operas for humdrum chores. It's time to get up, time to get up in the morning. Sweet melodies for everyday things. I remember. Do you remember how you used to sing like a child? Like a child, you used to sing like a child. Kathy, please don't be so quiet now. Kathy, where'd the music go? All those records you love so, dancing slow to Stevie Wonder. Joni was your favorite one. Yeah, she's from Saskatchewan, just like you, just like you. I remember. Do you remember how you used to sing like a child? You used to sing like a child. You used to sing like a child. Kathy, please don't be so quiet.
Ooh.
Lots of clapping. That's great. It's interesting that you picked up the banjo as your first song, having watched a lot of Our Native Daughters and having just that kind of rolling around my head about the genesis of that documentary. So maybe you could talk just a little bit about that, about how you arrived there in that space and what that was. I mean, one of the things that I remember about the documentary is Rhiannon saying, the biggest allies give us the space to do what we're going to do. And that's the best way that you can be an ally. And that really struck me about that movie. And I mean, so many things about that documentary. But maybe just talk about how you arrived with all those women. And
Well, Rhiannon and I go back to, we met each other in 2006, actually, at the Vancouver Folk Music Festival. I was there with my band Po Girl, and she was there with her first group, the Carolina Chocolate Drops. And they kind of exploded onto the scene, black string band playing Piedmont style, a lot of Piedmont style banjo and fiddle. And a lot of folks didn't realize when they came onto the scene that the roots, the foundations of a lot of that old time music, all the string bands, all the banjo players for 100 years in the Americas were black folks, because the banjo is, in fact, descended of African instruments, of the kind of Ngoni, the lute family, the African lute family. And it came, of course, with the diaspora, who came in chains on slave ships, you know, to the Americas. The oldest banjo in the Americas has been found in Haiti. It's called the Creole Bania. And, you know, so it's just, for a long, long time, string band music was played by black folks. And that is something which has not just been forgotten, but also purposefully erased, you know, unfortunately, due to racism and bigotry. And so it was mind blowing when I first heard Rhiannon and the Chocolate Drops. And we actually got put, back in those days, the festival would put artists up at the student dorms at the University of British Columbia. And this was not like fancy, glamorous living. Like, you were in these little kind of student like cells, you know, with single beds. And they were all sort of they would be in these towers and in a circle around one kind of shared, pretty gnarly bathroom. And you'd have like seven little bedrooms in these pods. And so Po Girl and the Chocolate Drops got put into one of these pods together. And you know, my partner in Po Girl, Anna Teixeira, and I and Rhiannon just hit it off. And I remember I was looking for what was recorded under race recordings. It was a compilation by the Library of Congress and Smithsonian, actually, called Sweet Petunias, which was early black women, blues women, race records. And it was this compilation, and they're incredible, just incredible songs, and a lot of stuff that has never been reissued anywhere, is hard to find. And Rhiannon, being the brilliant researcher that she is, like, found it for me within seconds online. I had never seen Skype before. And she and her partner at the time, who was in Ireland, were Skyping. And we, you know, nerded out about loving, both being able to recite Jabberwocky and both loving Star Trek, and like just a couple of nerds, you know. We were like, this is amazing. I've met another black nerd. This is so exciting. Like, you know, just deep bonding. And so we stayed in touch after that. And in 20, you know, we would run into each other on the festival scene. We collaborated on a couple of just other projects as well. We collaborated on a project called Keep a Song in Your Soul, which was an incredible piece that was a partnership with the Old Town School of Folk Music in Chicago, the Chocolate Drops at the time. Rhiannon hired me to be the clarinet player and also play City Girl in the piece. She was Country Girl, and she was representing, really, it was about the great migration of the Black diaspora from the Southern United States to Northern areas in the US. And it was telling that story through the music and sort of showing that unbroken lineage from the first songs that were annotated by Europeans hearing Black folks that were newly brought to the Americas in this horrific, traumatic way. But what did they bring with them? They brought with them histories, stories, strength, resilience, family. That's how they survived that horrific Middle Passage to get here. You know, that's already this unbelievable treasure of strength, you know, that that is carried forward in every living child of the diaspora, you know. And so it was just this powerful piece of, you know, Rhiannon is very interested, has always been a great musicologist and scholar, and bringing forward African-American contributions to American culture and to American history, because of course Black history is American history and Black music is American music and is foundational to all the popular musics now. You know, there would be no country, there would be no bluegrass, there would be no jazz, there would be no rock and roll, none of it without, there'd be no pop music without this foundational influence of the diaspora. And a lot of that has been forgotten and erased, and Rhiannon for a long time has been on a mission to bring that forward. And I was so, you know, I've been overjoyed over the years to join her in that. And when she visited the National Museum of African American History and Culture with her daughter Aoife, I think it would have been early 2018. And she was so struck, and there was a one poem in particular that kind of hit her, by William Cowper, who was a British abolitionist, and who wrote scathing indictments of the institution of slavery and was pivotal in helping Britain abolish the practice, and, you know, was trying to, was definitely partnered with abolitionists in the US as well. And the poem was basically like, you know, slavery is terrible, but I must be mum, for how could we do without sugar and rum? You know, it was this idea of these comforts, these creature comforts, how could we possibly do without them? And this is the only way to get them. Too bad, you know? And she was struck by that. And then she just had the kind of vision of, why don't we do a project really delving deeply into that painful history of minstrelsy, which was the most popular music in not just America, but around the world. It was the first big American export, minstrel music, which was written, a lot of it, by Black artists. But unfortunately, because of the racism of the time, it was presented often in blackface by white artists. And it was this horribly demeaning, derogatory, stereotyping and diminishing mockery of Black folks and Black culture. And so, you know, particularly when the diaspora fled the South due to not just looking for more opportunities in the North, but due to a, basically like a white supremacist domestic terror campaign against Black citizens, you know, they fled and went to the North, and they, you know, a lot of folks just never wanted to look back at that painful history. There's so much, there's so many layers of pain bound up in it all. But Rhiannon said, look, there's all this beautiful music too. So let's do something where we excavate some of this music. I want to do it with other women writers who are of, who come from this diaspora too, and who play the banjo, because the banjo is such, you know, in a way, the banjo, the story of the banjo is the story of America too, this incredible, born out of terrible strife and pain, but it's also this symbol of disparate cultures unifying and creating something beautiful that translates to all of these different folks all around the world, you know, and how powerful and gorgeous that is. I always think of, like, you know, Pete Seeger really adopted the banjo, and on it he wrote, this instrument surrounds hate and forces it to surrender, you know, and like that sort of idea, that notion of the banjo as a connector and also a liberator in many ways. And so she called me up and said, do you want to do this? Smithsonian has given me the green light. You know, she talked to, at the time, the director of the Smithsonian just said, absolutely, do it, write whatever you want, hire whoever you want to do it. Here you go, here's your budget, go for it. And yeah, that's what it, that's what she really meant by that, that kind of allyship, where he wasn't, you know, the Smithsonian, Smithsonian Folkways, you know, wonderful historic label, they weren't trying to dictate what we did. They just said, we trust you to say something that will be of value, so go for it. Mm-hmm. Here you go. And that's what she did. So she, you know, she called me up, she called Layla McCalla up, Amethyst Kia up. She also called up Valerie June and Kaya Cater, but they couldn't make it. So there would have been six of us if she'd had her way, but it didn't work with their schedule. So it was the four of us. And what quickly happened when we had this finite amount of time, we had 10 days together in Bow Bridge, Louisiana to record it. And we actually ended up writing mostly all original material. There were a few, Rhiannon did a beautiful version of this tune Barbados, which is the first, the earliest known recorded melody that came with the enslaved Africans to the Americas. And of course it was annotated by European, like we don't know, it's interpreted through a European's view or ears, but that is the earliest known piece of music that came with the diaspora to the Americans, to the Americas. So, you know, that was really powerful. And there are a few pieces like that, but most of it, we ended up, when we got together, the four of us, just this creative and personal explosion and communion. And we wrote and we wrote and we wrote, and we would be writing, you know, Amethyst and I were finishing a song at 3 a.m. the night before, recording it the next morning at 11 a.m. And the whole process was like that. It was just this very, I didn't know Amethyst well going into it. I'd met her a couple of times. I'd met Layla a couple of times. Rhiannon was kind of we were all connected to Rhiannon. But then when we got together in this little Airbnb in Louisiana, you know, in the bayou of Louisiana, it was such a deep communion and sense of kinship and sisterhood and all the things that we didn't have to say and all the things that we, you know, we're finishing each other's sentences and similar experiences being sort of somewhat tokenized, I guess is the word, and exoticized in these, you know, Americana roots milieus that we had all been working in that are, you know, clearly predominantly white in these times. So it was just a really powerful, beautiful experience. And we had the allyship of so many wonderful, the National Museum of African American History and Culture, you know, helped support this project, this Smithsonian Folkways, and they just gave us free rein, like do what you, follow your vision, follow your art, we trust you, you know, and we had no idea that it would have that kind of a response, you know, that all of the kind of awards and nominations and 5-star reviews in the Guardian, like the stuff that was like, what? Like, I can't believe this is happening. Or this is so surreal. And it was really encouraging. Like, apparently there are, you know, there's this trope in, particularly in roots music, particularly in country music, which is, you know, clearly struggling with some deep-seated bigotry in the industry of country music. This idea that people don't really listen to women and don't want to, you know, that's why it's so hard. Even folks like Kacey Musgraves, who's won Grammy after Grammy and every award, she's incredible performer and writer, beautiful writer. I think she's a wonderful writer. They won't play her on the radio, you know, on country radio, they don't play her music. And she's a white woman, a gorgeous white woman who can't get played on country radio, you know? And so I think, let alone Mickey Guyton, let alone Reese Palmer, you know, let alone any of the amazing Black country artists sort of working more in mainstream country. They don't get played. And it's this idea, no one wants to hear women and they really don't want to hear Black women, you know? And so it was so encouraging and uplifting that no, apparently there's a bunch of people that do want to hear 4 nerdy Black women playing banjos and singing our little hearts out, you know? So it's cool. Been an incredible experience. And it kind of turned into a band without us realizing, you know, we made a project and then suddenly we realized, oh wait, I guess we're a band, you know? So we're definitely going to do another record. We're talking about doing a writing residency a little bit later this year. So yeah, we are finding ways now that there's a little bit of light at the end of the tunnel with the vaccines rolling out and, you know, hopefully we will soon be all together in a room again, writing some music.
Yeah. I just wanted to say too, that people who are out listening, you can put questions and answers in the Q&A. You can put things in the chat and we can respond. We turned to this format so that we could have sort of a conversation with our community, because soon enough, I think that we'll be able to see Allie perform all over the digital world when your album comes out on Friday. And so we just kind of wanted to make
it. The whole record doesn't come out. Just a bit of it.
Something's going to happen.
And the announcement of like the official street date. Yeah.
But when it does come out, I think the opportunity for seeing you digitally will be robust for us here in Humboldt. Yeah. So please feel free to link in the chat and have a comment or a question or anything, and we'll move forward. Yeah. So that being said, how about do you have anything from that, Our Native Daughters? And I think of, is it Kashiba?
Yes. Would you like me to play that? I would be happy.
Eventually, maybe you could play what you were going to play and that one too for me.
I'd be happy to play. I just was leaving it wide open to like,
What do you got in the back of your banjo there? What's in the back of your banjo?
You know what? It's just scarves. Okay. And the reason is banjo. So mine, this is an Americana Good Time banjo. So it's got a 13 inch resonator, but it's open back. And it's got a deeper tone, and I've tried to make it sound sort of as much like an Ngoni as I can with like a fake goat skin. It's called a fiber skin made, I think it's Remo that makes them. And I put a special bridge on it, and I changed the strings from steel strings to Nile gut, which is like fake gut strings basically, to make it sound kind of as deep and rich and warm as I can. And then this helps just with the overtones so that it sounds a little more in tune. I'm playing it. That's always the challenge with a banjo, is the tuning. But I would be happy to play Kashiba. This is one that I wrote during Our Native Daughters sessions for the album that we made on Smithsonian called Songs of Our Native Daughters. And Kashiba is the many times great, great matriarch of my biological paternal line. And I met my biological family about 10 years ago now, for the first time, my paternal family. And that has just been this joyous, joyous kind of journey of discovery, of really understanding where I come from and all sides of my lineage, my mom's side, which is Scottish, and my biological father's side, which is Grenadian. And we think possibly Ghanaian before that. We know that Kashiba was sold off the coast of Ghana, but of course we don't know, you know, that was one of the big ports of export of humans, and we don't know, people were kidnapped from all over, so we don't know of course for sure where she was from, but in this I'm imagining, I know that her last exit from the African continent and everything she knew and loved was Ghana, so I just feel grateful to know her name. I feel grateful for her strength and resilience and improbable ability to keep hope alive through circumstances that I don't even want to imagine. And I get to be here because of her strength and resilience. And my daughter gets to be here and carries that strength forward. So I'm going to sing this in her honor. And I want to make a point that all of us alive on this planet today come from, doesn't matter what your lineage or heritage or background is, we come from long lines of survivors, you know, who went through times far worse than these and lived through them. And that is something to celebrate and strength to draw from, I believe. Oh, thank you, Kim. It's my pleasure.
So Kim says, thank you for sharing the history of and your personal connection to the music.
All right, so here's Kashiba. For all our ancestors, we are living their wildest dreams. ¶¶
Lady of love, born and unborn by the grace of your strength, we have life. From the Golden Coast of Ghana to the bondage of Grenada, you kept the dream of hope alive. Burned your body, they cursed your blackness, but they could not take your light. Kashiba, Kashiba, you're free now, you're free now. How does your spirit flare? Blood of your blood, bone of your bone, by the grace of your strength, we have life. Raped and beaten, your baby is taken. Sold and starved and sold again. But ain't you a man of love deserving? And it's something you survive. Kashiba, Kashiba.
Sound of many hands clapping here at the Arcata Playhouse. Imagine, if you will, squeaky chairs, hands clapping, people saying more, more, more.
I hear it
in my mind.
I hear them in my mind too. Soon we will hear them in our actual minds.
I know it will come back.
We're it will come closer. Back. It will come back.
We started the 1C phase of vaccines here in Nashville, and I got mine for the first one, and JT got his today, and our dear housemate Yola is getting hers Monday, and it sounds like by May 1st, every adult will be eligible, and it's just thrilling.
Yes, we're
getting closer to the.
Exactly. Oh, we have some comments in the chat here. That was beautiful. Yay. Thanks, oh, Allie. Thank love you. From Katie Belfast.
Hi, Katie. Hola. I love you and I miss you. Oh my gosh. I miss Arcata.
They're doing awesome things over there at the sanctuary. That is for sure. Katie and
incredible.
Solomon,
we got to visit the sanctuary right before the shutdown, basically. So in March of exactly right around this time last year. And we were traveling, opening for the Wood Brothers. And we did, like, our last show that we did was basically, we had just done the Fox Theater in Oakland, opening for the Wood Brothers with Birds of Chicago. We opened for them. And then we were supposed to be playing in Portland, driving up the coast. And we got to stop at the sanctuary and experience that beauty. And that's right, for your birthday. That's right, Katie.
And oh, that's right. Birthday. And you went to, I met you at, didn't I meet you at Renata's Creperie too?
Yes. It was like this magical right before, you know, we were still in this lovely blissed out ignorance. I was like, oh no. Just right after that, a couple of days later, we flew back. Of course, the tour was canceled, the rest of it. And we flew back to Nashville, which is where I live now. JT and I and our daughter Ida live in Nashville now. And I'm in my music room here in Nashville. This has been my broadcast central throughout the pandemic. Have not gone anywhere since then, basically. So that's, yeah, it's
there's
wild.
There's a comment from a licensed user. I heard about your album and bought it a few months back. I absolutely love it. So I was delighted to learn you'd be at Zero to Fierce and you're a friend of Jackie's. I'm so inspired.
Thank you so much. Thank you for buying the music too. That is just, you know, music is free now, but you can still buy it, as our friend Rain Rose always says. And we are so appreciative when people do. It's a huge thing. We don't take that lightly. Oh, so my goodness.
Wait, standing. Oh, from Terry Uweki. Will always be grateful to the Playhouse for introducing me to your music, and I've been such a fan of yours and Birds and have caught you at the Folk Alliance the past 3 years. Asking Allie, though it may be difficult to parse, in what ways does she feel that being a mother and mother to a daughter informs her songwriting and her most recent growth as a musical artist? Good question, Terry.
It's a great question, and basically in every way, and it's changed everything for me in so many ways. I mean, one of the things about being a survivor of severe childhood abuse, it has been very hard for me to love myself. And when I became a mother to a daughter, I understood on a cellular level that I had to learn how to be loving to both myself and her, you know, in order to be loving to her and make sure that no cycle could ever be repeated for her that occurred for me. And it also really galvanized me to understand that now as a mother, I mean, and you don't have to be a physical mother to know this, but it shook me awake in a sense of that I am now, it is my responsibility. I need to be a good ancestor for not just my kid, but all the generations to come. And if I don't, I need to be able to look my daughter in the eyes and say, I did everything I could to make this better for you and for every other particular, you know, it's not saying that terrible things don't happen to men and boys as well, but statistically we know there's just much higher incidences of violence for women. And I mean, women with an X, you know, whether it's women, whether you're trans woman, cis woman, non-binary, you know, the incidences of violence are higher, that has been my lived experience as well. And I was galvanized in every way to be braver, to be more vocal, to go to talk about the uncomfortable things that have to be talked about if we're going to change them, if we're going to heal, if we're going to move forward with greater empathy and love and compassion, and make better outcomes for all our children, and especially our girls. So yes, in every way, thank you for that question. I mean, becoming Ida's mom was literally transformative and metaphorically transformative. And she, every day, I just feel like I have to be worthy that she chose me as a mother, and I have to keep pushing, and I have to be more honest, and I have to be braver, you know. And that's that love, it made me really truly understand that love is not passive, it is active. It is an active choice every day. And so I have to choose that every day, and I have to choose to do whatever I can to reduce harm in the world. You know, that's how I feel. And of course, everything feels more urgent now since her birth for me. And this record, I don't know that I would ever have made a solo record. And on the record, it's called Outside Child. And I'm really delving into, I'm excavating a lot of the pain of my past. And really the record isn't really about abuse. It's about transcendence, resilience, survival, and the power for me, the life-saving power that was discovering my artist voice and artist community, and the finding your chosen family when your biological family maybe couldn't be loving towards you, and that there is, that it gets better, that there's hope, that is not, if that was your experience or is your experience, that you're not forever trapped there, that there's love beyond that, and that we all contain these multitudes. And even if you have that kind of trauma in your life, that doesn't have to be the whole story or the only story, that we're more than the sum of our scars. And that for me, artistic expression, being able to channel everything that I feel through songwriting and writing, has been life-changing and life-saving. Literally, music saved my life. I don't know that I would have gotten through and not just music, books, you know, plays, movies, going to see Jackie in Blood Clan, you know, like these things. I'm serious.
Though. You won't find it online.
It changed my ideas of what it gives you, that inkling that there is another way to live. It doesn't have to be this, you know. And that's really what the record is about. And the reason I wrote it wasn't because, oh, everybody listened to my story and what happened to me. It was like, it's not me. It's we're dealing with a pandemic right now that's awful. Absolutely. COVID's awful. But what is worse to me are the pandemics of bigotry and abuse. And those are the twin pandemics that have been plaguing our beautiful one human race for all of, you know, for all of our existence. And we are just, what I find hopeful though, is that we now think that bigotry and abuse are wrong. And that's what's new, right? It's not, Me Too isn't new. Like this kind of, this happening on such a broad level isn't new. What's new is that we're saying out loud now and to each other, and recognizing how many of us have these shared experiences, that this is wrong and we have to change it. And it doesn't change without us talking about it, you know? And that's what has been, to me, so encouraging, even about this last year of so much pain and trauma and tragedy and loss. But also, I have felt this real sense of a global community forming, and particularly amongst women, reaching out to each other and saying, we are really strong. We're not a minority, right? Women aren't minorities. Black people aren't minorities. Indigenous people aren't minorities. BIPOC people aren't minorities. LGBTQIA plus people aren't minorities. When we all of these, all of us in these groups that are othered, and a lot of us are at these intersections of these groups, we are not minorities. When you look at all of us, we are by far the majority. Like, women are the majority of the world. That's the truth. There are more of us. That is just true. We're not a minority, you know. So that understanding and being able to connect and being able to support one another and being able to process trauma by also sharing those stories with each other. I mean, that's a huge part of the communion of our Native daughters. And that's a huge part of the communion that I'm seeing online. And so many, particularly for me, Instagram has been actually a strangely healing space during this this last year of more isolation than I've ever experienced in my life, of this sense of community and learning and just circles, magic sort of circles of protection that are forming virtually. And those are real. There's having real life effects, changing laws. There's a woman, there's a Black woman. She's Madam Vice President. Like that's huge, you know, that's a huge step forward. So whatever your political beliefs, that is a ceiling that's now been shattered. And that's a good thing, you know, for everybody. But yeah, it's really been just Ida spurs me to do better and be stronger and be braver and be more vocal and, you know, not accept, be very clear, much clearer about my own boundaries so that she knows it's okay to say, no, that's not right. That doesn't feel right to me. Absolutely not. I had no, you know, that was one of the fallout of, you know, of my childhood experience was having such difficulty with boundaries of being able to acknowledge when I'm really uncomfortable, this doesn't feel right to me. No, you know, I'm not going to do this, or no, thank you. That's not for me. No, thanks. And that was just so hard for me to learn how to say no, thank you. For the longest time, that was really difficult. And now every day I just think about ways that how can I make things a little safer and a little better for her and have her horizon open wider than mine did at her age. And she's incredibly lucky to have a wonderful dad as well. Like my partner is just a fabulous dad. And that's one of the things I say, no matter how, you know, all of us, we're all going to screw up our kids in one way or another. Every child is going to be like, you did this and it was awful. Like, there's no way, you can't be perfect. Right. But you do your best. And one thing that I am just very proud of is I've given her a really good dad, you know, and so.
And you covered a Billie Eilish tune.
And
she was really excited about that you covered a Billie Eilish tune.
She really was like, okay, Billie Eilish, just like
things are okay.
She was like, okay, mom, you're cool now. You covered a Billie Eilish song. Oh my goodness.
Harriet Wecky says, and in Brianna's name, thank you.
Yes. Yeah. Today, a year, you know, she should be here. She should be here now. You know, it's like she was 26 years old. You know, and just there's not been resolution for her family. There's not been, it just, it's hard, you know, this is why we need to be, not need to be, I'm not telling anyone else what to do, why I feel compelled every day to try and do something to push for real equality, right? And it's just, you know, empathy is an exercise. It drives Ida crazy. I'm like, empathy is a superpower and you have to practice it every day. And, you know, this kind of, but it's true. And that's what art does. And Jackie, I just want to say congratulations for the business of the year. Is that right? That was just awarded recently for Playhouse. And it's
from the Chamber.
From the Chamber of Commerce. And I just think that is brilliant that your county, that Arcata is recognizing the importance of uplifting arts businesses and nonprofit businesses, that these are just as important as Fortune 500 for creating healthy, well-rounded, nonviolent citizens. You know, like if you want healthy, happy people, art is what does that. Art builds empathy. All art, you know, it doesn't matter if it's a play or a movie or a book or a poem or painting, you know, or sculpture or a song, it builds empathy. And
it's really been a theme of the festival too, just talking with, you know, sort of various people that have woven throughout the festival of using of the arts, really helping for healing, for moving forward, for love, for a fierce kind of love. Definitely. A theme of the festival. So we talked a little bit about fierce love and we had a little chit chat about bell hooks and fierce love and love in the revolution. And just wondering if you have any sort of, there it is, all about love.
I like my book.
One day we're going to have a thing with the sanctuary where we'll do a book club about all about love, but use artistic rendering rather than just talking about it. So here's what I'm wondering is if you have a couple of songs up your sleeve, which are, you know, within that theme, because you have such fierce love and resilience. You're such a lovely, beautiful person who speaks with such truth and honesty. And just to give you a chance to bust out a couple of tunes in that lovely way, doing that hoodoo that you do.
All right. I would love to do that. I do have a couple of tunes like that. Let me see here.
I'm sure you do.
So I'm going to play you. Let's see if I can do it. This is one off the new record, actually.
Yeah, I'm a midnight rider, stone bone of fire night flyer. I'm an angel of the morning too. Promise that the dawn will bring you. Ooh. I'm the melody in the space between every note the swallow sings. I'm 14 vultures circling. I'm that crawling, dying thing. I'm the smoke up above the trees, good Lord. The fire in the branches burning, Lord. Maybe you were sleeping, Lord. But Mary, she's not weeping no more, no. Ooh. Yeah, I'm a midnight rider, stone bone of fire night flyer. I'm an angel of the morning too. Promise that the dawn will bring you. I'm the sick light of a hurricane's eye. I'm a violent lullaby. I'm 6 fireflies, one street light. I'm a suffocating summer night. Mm-hmm. I'm each of the steps on the stairway, his shadow in the doorframe. I'm the tap tap of a lunar moth. I'm the stale beer on his breath. His soul is trapped in that room, but I crawled back in my mother's womb. I came back out with my gold and my dreams. Now I see everything. Now I feel everything, good Lord. What the hell could they bring to stop me, Lord? Nothing from the earth, nothing from the sea. Not a God Almighty thing. I'm a midnight rider, stone born a finite flyer. I'm an angel of the morning too. Promise that the dawn will bring you. I'm the wounded bear, I'm the screaming hawk, I'm the one who can't be counted out. I'm the dove thrown into battle, I can roll and shake and rattle. I'm the moon's dark side, I'm the solar flare, the child of the earth, the child of the air. I am the mother of the evening star, I am the love that conquers all. Yeah, I'm a midnight rider, stone bone of fire night flyer. I'm an angel of the morning too. Promise that the dawn will bring you. Yeah, I'm a midnight rider, stone bone of fire night flyer. I'm an angel of the morning. to promise that the door will be you. I am the mother of the evening star. I'm the love that conquers all.
So that's a new one.
Called that's Night beautiful. Life.
Thank you. I was like, I don't remember how to play the chords in my own song. I've been playing it on clarinet. I was like, I'll play. No, just gonna do it a cappella.
That's great.
That's so funny. They're so big, you know, brand new. And I play, I got really into playing clarinet. I sort of, that one came to me sort of as a clarinet melody first. And then the words came and so it's so funny. I haven't really like played it on the banjo yet, you know. So anyway, but this one, this next one that I'll do is very much in that line of fierce love and universal love and love. It's written, I wrote this during the Native Daughters sessions toward the end of the sessions. And I was really missing Ida. It was my first separation from her. We actually recorded that record in January of 2018, and then it came out February of 2019. But Ida was only 4 when we recorded it, and it was my first big separation from her because she came with her dad and I on tour. She was a band baby, road baby for the first 4 years of her life, until she had an intervention with her dad and I and said she wanted to go to school. And that's when we started like, okay, I guess we need to change it up a little bit how we've been doing things. And that's been a big impetus as well for starting to do some separate artistic endeavors so that both parents aren't gone all the time. One parent can always be, of course we're all home now, but when things resume, I will be going out and touring the solo record, and JT will be staying home, being at home dad and writing here in Nashville and doing a lot of producing work as well. So we're figuring it out to kind of stagger things in that way. But anyway, long story to say, I was really, really missing Ida. It was this incredible communion with my dear sisters, but I was really missing Ida. Layla was missing her kids. Rhiannon was missing her kids. So we were just kind of communing as moms too. It was this, Rhiannon's kids are older, so she had experienced, being apart from them before, but it was, I was really grateful at the same time that I knew she was in the lap of love with her dad, and not just her dad, but our whole loving community, this incredible community of artists who are also raising young families here in Nashville, and that she was surrounded by love, even though I wasn't there. And at the same time that I knew and recognized that she was surrounded by love, there were these, I don't know how many children in complete deprivation, fear, terror, literally in cages at our border, that same moment, I was very cognizant of this privilege that my child has, that every child should have. It shouldn't be privilege. It should just be, that's how it is. You are surrounded by love and you are cared for and your needs are met. And that is not what is happening for every child. And we are failing our kids, as our global children. And, I just, again, finding ways to be part of solutions for that is a top priority for me now. So this song is called You're Not Alone, and none of us are ever alone. And everything we do has a ripple effect, right? For everybody. And You're Not Alone. And this is called You're Not Alone, but it's really a song of love. And it's written towards Ida, but it's not meant just for Ida. It's meant for all our kids. Thank you.
star and a compass. Always finding something wondrous. Anywhere you go, you're not alone. Rocks and bugs and angel wings. Every little shiny thing. Thank you.
Yay! Lots of.
That's an awesome song.
Thank
that made you. Me tear up a little bit. So thanks for that. Now I don't know what to say.
You're not alone. I cry.
I'm not alone. I feel that I'm probably not alone in this feeling that I'm feeling, these feels that I'm feeling right now.
Oh, my daughter Ida yesterday, you know, was just, she's an empath, right? She just feels it all. And she was sobbing and she turned to me. She's like, it's not okay to feel this sad. And I said, yes, it is. It's okay to feel this sad. It's okay. And it will pass. And we're gonna feel better again, you know, but it's okay. It's absolutely okay. Like she'd been, you know, you can just tell when she was like, everything's great, everything's fine, you know, like holding it in and like, you don't have to, you can be that sad. It's allowed. It's okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
These are hard times. They're sad times. You're missing people. You're losing people. It's okay to grieve. You know, I feel like that is one of the things that I feel like in our North American culture anyway, that we've really lost that ease of communal grieving, you know, of being able to grieve together. And there's this kind of like, if someone asks you how you are, you're supposed to be fine, you know, but nobody's fine right now. Who's fine? Nobody's fine, you know? So it's like.
And it's also to not know the way and not know the answer. I mean, I think that's one of the biggest things with the pandemic, and sort of, it's interesting, the arc of the festival landing here tonight, and talking to women from, you know, from Yurok women to today we had Centro del Pueblo to, you know, Patty Johnson talking about camping to handwork with Amelia Similius Bisher and voting with the ballot and panels and activist panels and all these women talking about ways that really they're saying we're not alone. And yeah, a lot of the arc of this one woman that talks about Woman Who Blooms at Night, a story about a young Native woman coming away from an abusive relationship and really looking to her cultural center to help deliver her from this relationship. Like you say, to learn to love yourself and find your strength. And I think that is the ancient root. That is the ancient root that we tap into when you sing and say the words, we're not alone. When I hear my friend Rachel Sundberg sing her flower dance song, I'm like, I just feel this connection, this ancient connection to things being pulled up from, I don't know where, from somewhere being delivered, laid at the table for us to snack on and eat.
Yeah. And so, connecting with each other and supporting one another. I just think, you know, there's been such a concerted effort to keep women in a place of like false scarcity and competition with one another over these supposedly, you know, there's only room for one singer and the woman singer on the radio. There's only room for one woman writer. There's only these tokenized, those are only ones you all have to compete and scrap it up. And that's just false. It's just totally false. And where I feel like where I've found my, I've always instinctively known that was false, you know, that women don't need to compete. It's not about competing. It's not about, you know, comparison being the thief of joy or any of that nonsense. Like that there's world enough for all of us, you know, and when we really see and support each other, it just changes everything, you know. I mean, it was such a fascinating process to go through with our Native daughters, where, you know, for each of, I mean, Rhiannon certainly the most well-known of us, and, you know, choosing to share her platform and invite more sisters in and share this resource that had been given to her. She could have gone and made the record by herself, you know, and she chose to bring her sisters into it, and it shifted it, you know. The whole is greater than the sum of the parts, always, you know. That's how our world is. The whole is greater than the sum of the parts, and that's how it works when we reach out and do things in community and where we can really change things. I mean, we just saw that in Georgia. It's incredible. That's a relatively few, very passionate, committed women changing the course of history, you know? Mm-hmm. And that is, there's so much power in that kind of communion, you know, that I feel, it's thrilling and it's healing and it's, you know, it's the opposite of divisive violence, you know, it's literally what heals us, this coming together and recognizing each other's strength and excellence, essentially, you know, like that, how beautiful that is. And,
right. I just have a couple comments in the chat here. Kristen says your songwriting and storytelling are so heartfelt, honest, and beautiful. Lynn Glenn says, this is the best thing I've seen during my year on Zoom. Allie is so eloquent. Jackie and Allie's relationship is so inspiring. I hope we can see Allie on the Playhouse stage soon.
I hope so too.
Next year at the Women's Festival, we'll reprise the whole festival, but in person. Because there were so many amazing things that happened.
Oh, it would be so beautiful. And I would love, I miss obviously playing, and that kind of, you know, I'm hooked on that communion of live shows. That's what it is for me. That's, I'm not, you know, a religious person. I would call myself like a hopeful agnostic, I think, but there is that need for a spiritual communal experience of some sort, I think, or I felt that. And that for me is fulfilled by that sacred rite of playing for a room full of people. It's not a one-way thing. It's an exchange. It's always an exchange. It's always a communion. And that is one of the reasons why the Playhouse is so special to me, is there's this intimacy and this
awesome audience,
very palpable, awesome audience, a very palpable exchange that happens, you know, because it isn't, you know what that's like, Jackie, where some, you know, some shows where you feel like all the energy gets sucked away and none of it comes back. Right. And that, and that can happen sometimes. And that's just, maybe sometimes that's like maybe a community that hasn't been exposed to as much live stuff. So they don't realize that it's two ways or something, but that's, you know, it's so joyful coming to Arcata because it's like so many people are artists themselves in the audience. And there's that, just that palpable, we're doing this together. We're having this exchange. And I love that. It's my favorite. Yeah.
Yes, this is, I love it as well
too. And you know, Zoom is filling the breach to some extent. Like this is communion too, you know. It's not as great as when we get to actually be together, but it's better than nothing, you know.
Like, yeah, and there's something to it. I think that we'll live on after Zoom, you know, not after Zoom is gone, but you know, that will live on after the pandemic, that there are definitely merits to
environmental
what we're doing things, and definitely the resilience and access that we learned a lot of holes in this Zoom time, in, you know, in where there were holes, and now we can begin to fill them, like HR1 and the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. Oh, sorry, did I say that out loud? But you know, all these holes that need to be filled are apparent. It's like we've driven the bumpy road and jostled our brains, and now we see where the potholes are that we can now go back and
had time fill. To process.
Time
to process. So, I think about that so much, like trauma, which we're all of us have inherited this, you know, generational trauma, right? We all have whatever our lineages and experiences, there's all of this kind of generational trauma that we're all surrounded by. And how do we process that? And how do we change the outcomes now? Like, how do we change the script? Like, rewrite it. That's what I think this time of enforced stillness relatively has actually been really beneficial for processing that, right? To getting to, I thought it was so interesting, like the kind of, it was almost like the stages of grief that the globe was going through collectively at different times, of like some people are still stuck in denial, like COVID isn't real or whatever, right? And some people have already processed through to grieving the losses and now getting to how can we reduce harm, you know, where do we, what are the next steps to reduce harm coming out of this? This is actually an opportunity, as you said, this is actually an opportunity to move forward with greater intention and purpose and hopefully effectiveness, you know.
And open minds to things that would not have been, you know, the fact that we are doing this here and there are people sitting and we're all listening over Zoom or over this would not be a thing. And just the things that we're open to now, like a universal wage and healthcare. So, you know, that before would have been like flash points and nobody would have talked about it. So those kind of things are great. I have to say to everybody who's listening that we haven't had the heat on in the theater for an hour now, or possibly an hour and a half. And if you'll all remember how cold it gets in here when we can't have the heater on. I just want to share that visceral experience with the audience.
Are you freezing right now?
No, I'm not freezing. I'm not freezing. I'm warm from within and I'm in menopause. So I constantly have a hot furnace going.
You're like, come on, hot flash. This is the time.
Yeah, exactly. But it's just kind of bringing that visceral experience that we are at the Playhouse back to everybody that the chairs are still squeaky and the heater is still loud. Hopefully the heater will be fixed by the time we come back in. But
yeah.
Well, Allie, I thank you so much for being with us tonight. I feel like we could talk for hours and hours, and one day you will come here and maybe one day I will come there, or
yes,
who knows where these
things
will go.
You're our guest anytime you come through part of the world. And Jackie has put up our whole band before, like forever in your debt. Like, yeah.
Wow, that's good to know. Shouldn't say that out loud to me, everyone on this.
You can say it. I'm on record. I'm on record.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening, for taking the time to talk. My question is, do you have time for one last song before you go? Would that be okay?
Of course. Yes, great. That would be so okay. And I'm going to leave you with this one. Everybody, Jackie knew my grandma Isabel, and she was a complicated lady, but I got the best of her in many ways. And I'm so grateful for that relationship that I had with her. And she brought so many wonderful, like old creepy murder ballads and lullabies from her old country, which was Scotland. And that has been a big influence for me in my writing and my imagination and all of the rest of it. And I was missing her, and she, you know, was taken too soon by Alzheimer's. But I do believe that love doesn't die. That's, you know, again, I'm not a religious person with religious convictions, but I believe one thing is that love doesn't die. And so this is kind of a song that I wrote when I was feeling really small and powerless, but I thought about my grandma Isabel and how intrepid and indomitable she was, and kind of tried to channel her into this song. So this is like something that I sing when I feel like I need bolstering and to be braver. And I think of her, and I think of all our loved ones that we've lost physically, but whose love still, I believe, still surrounds us and protects us. So this is Barley, and I'll leave you with this one. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Jackie, I adore you.
I love you.
And thank you for having me here, Zero to First Women's Festival. So I will leave you with Barley. Let me give myself an A minor, so I make sure I'm singing it in the right key.
The wind that shakes the barley, it will not shake me. The wind that shakes the barley will not shake me. The wind that shakes the barley won't shake me. As my grandma told me, this I sow, though that I see. And the fire that takes the kindling, it will not take me. The fire that takes the kindling will not take me. The fire that takes the kindling won't take me. As my grandma told me, this I saw, though that I see. The rain that floods the valley, it will not drown me. The rain that floods the valley will not drown me. The rain that floods the valley won't drown me. sorrow that I see, and the hack that stoops to spill will not strike me. The hack that stoops to spill will not strike me. The hack that stoops to spill will strike me. As my grandma told me, this I sorrow that I see, and the dark before the dawn breaks will not bind me. The dark before the dawn breaks will not bind me. The dark before the dawn breaks will bind me. As my grandma told me, this I sorrow that I see. Wind that shakes the valley will not shake me. The wind that shakes the valley will not shake me. The wind that shakes the valley won't shake, shake me. As my grandma told me, this I saw though that I see. As my grandma told me, this I saw though that I see. As my grandma told me, this I saw though that I see. And my grandma told me, this I saw, know that I see.
Nice. Oh, Isabel.
Trying to channel some of her old stories. That saying, that I sow, though this I see, it comes from an old Scottish kind of ghost story about a tailor who gets hired by this feudal lord to try and rid the local church of a terrible ghost. And no one has been able to last the night. You have to sit through the church till dawn to rid the church of this ghost, and know everyone's run screaming, all the knights and all the things. And this tailor, you know, a humble tailor, goes and he survives, and he rids the town of the ghost, because he keeps, so, you know, the ghost is doing these things to terrify him. And he says, that I see, but this I sow. I see. And over and over again, he just stays focused on his sewing. And I always thought that was such a beautiful metaphor for, you know, so many times when we're kind of on our path and someone is going, you can't do that, that's not for you, absolutely not. And you go, I hear you. This is what I'm doing.
I wanted to show the picture of you and Isabel one more time at the Notre Dame de Grâce in Montreal. There you are.
I miss her. I miss her so much. Look at that ridiculous dress.
You're trying to climb up, get up there.
I know, I'm like, hey, can I quit? I want to fly.
Yeah. So the last comments, beautiful soul, love her, says Tina McKenzie. Me too. You are a beautiful soul, Allison Russell. And I wish you all the best of everything this world has to offer you. And I will see you one day soon.
I hope
which
so.
Soon being having two O's in the middle of it, that maybe can have more O's than just two. So it could be soon, or it could be soon. So it will be somewhere in that where the O's will
somewhere in there between
contract or expand. Thank you for taking the time to be with us. Bless you, JT and Ida. And thank you, everybody, for joining us. Zero to Fear starts again tomorrow with a panel, Love in Action, with some of our local faith leaders. We will be talking about love in the revolution and how we put our fierce womanly love into action in our community. That will be followed by a memorial to Jeannie McCovey, UROC environmental leader. And then we're going to wrap it all up by making some food together. Feel free to join us, Allison. We're going to make spanakopita and learn how to use phyllo and make a Caesar salad, and then eat it all together and have a closing ceremony. And that will be the
amazing end
of the fifth annual Zero to Fierce Festival. It is Daylight Savings Day tomorrow time. Right. Spring forward.
Spring forward.
Spring forward. And we spring forward with love.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank
so
you.
So much love. Thank you so much for having me. So much love to all of you. Thank you for joining us.
And happy birthday, Jace. And thank you, Shoshana. And thank you, Mackenzie. And thank you to Haley for being on this journey.
Thank you.
Peace, love, rock and rolls, babies.
Peace, love, rock and roll. Bye.
Bye.